dependency injection or dependency inversion. To write high-quality code, you're gonna need both. But what's the difference? Let's find out. If you're new here, you want to become a better software developer, gain a deeper understanding of programming in general, start now by subscribing and hitting the bell so you don't miss anything. First, some terminology. When we talk about dependency in object-oriented programming, we usually refer to an object type that a class has a direct relationship with. You can also say that this direct dependency means that the class and the object type are coupled. For example, a class could depend on another class because it has an attribute of that type, or because an object of that type is passed as a parameter to a method, or because the class inherits from that other class. These are all examples of dependencies. The strongest dependency relationship is inheritance. Inheritance introduces coupling that's really hard to remove, because subclasses will often directly use attributes and other methods from the superclass all over the place. This is also why, in general, composition is often a better choice than inheritance. But I'll cover that in more detail in a separate video. Dependency injection is a design pattern. The idea of the pattern is that if a class uses an object of a certain type, we're not also making that class responsible for creating that object. Because it shifts the creation responsibility to another class, dependency injection is an inversion of control technique. A big advantage of dependency injection is that as a result, your code becomes much easier to test, as I'll show you in a minute. Dependency inversion is a principle that's part of the solid design principles by our good old friend Uncle Bob. That principle aims to decouple concrete classes using abstractions, abstract classes, interfaces, etc. Because you need the class type in order to construct the object, this also means that dependency inversion is only possible if you separate creation from use. In other words, without dependency injection, there is no dependency inversion. If you've watched some of my earlier videos, perhaps you recognize this example. I have an order, I have an authorizer, and I have a payment processor. The idea is that the system will allow a customer to buy something, place an order, and pay that order and add some authorization. In this case, authorization happens via SMS. So if you look at order, it's pretty simple. I didn't store any information here about what the order actually contains. It simply has an ID that's generated as a random string, and it has a payment status that's at the moment open. And you can change that status by calling a setStatus method. The SMS authorizer can generate an SMS code, and it can authorize that code by asking the user to input the code. And then it simply checks that the codes are the same. It also has an isAuthorized method so that other objects can check whether the payment should be authorized or not. The payment processor has a simple pay method that takes an order. This creates an SMS authorizer, it generates code, authorizes it, and then if it's authorized, it prints this out and then it changes the order status to paid. And otherwise, it raises an error. That's how it's been set up. So we have these three classes, order, authorizer, and payment processor. I also wrote some tests. This is the set of test cases. So I have a test case for the order. In the order test case, I check when I create an order that the status initially is open. I also have a test for checking that set status actually sets the order status correctly. So that's what you see here. I have an SMS authorizer test case that's a bit similar. So I have an initializer test that checks whether initially is authorized is set to false, which is what we want it to be. Then there is a test that checks whether a code is actually a decimal code, which is what we need for SMS codes. And then we have an authorized success test and an authorized fail test. And what's nice about this authorized success case is that it actually uses patch, which is a feature of the unit testing system in Python, to replace what happens when you call the input function. So in this case, it replaces the input function by something that has a fixed return value. And that's needed because if you look at the SMS authorizer, you see that the authorize method calls input to request the user what the SMS code is going to be. And obviously, whenever we run these unit tests, we don't want to manually enter all these codes for our tests to run. So here we are replacing the built-in input with a fixed return value. So what we're doing is we generate the SMS code. The return value is that actual code, so that means it was entered correctly. We call authorize and then we check that isAuthorize is indeed true after calling this authorize method. This method is a test for the fail case. And they use patched slightly differently here. So here you see we're using it as a method, but here you see we can also use it as a decorator. So in this case, I use it to replace the input with a fixed return value again, but this time I'm returning 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which I know is always going to be a false authorization code because the authorizer generates a 6-digit SMS code. So what's happening here, I create the authorizer, I generate the SMS code, I call authorize, and then I assert that is authorized is false after I've done this. Payment processor, I also like to add tests, but this is difficult at the moment. Let's look at the code one more time to see what's happening in that pay method. So you see we create inside the pay method the SMS authorizer and call some methods on it and then check whether it's authorized or not. So as a result, it's really hard to test for success or failure cases because there's no way to actually directly set the code for testing. And the problem is that the pay method is responsible for creating the object, which means that we can't create it here, set some test value and then pass it to the pay method. Now unit test has a mock part in the library that allows you to create mock objects and replace objects that are used in functions with other objects. It's complicated. I tried to get this to work, but I didn't manage to do it. Perhaps you guys can figure out what I should write here to actually test this case. I'm not sure how to solve that. In any case, it shows that it's hard to test these kind of functions that create their own objects because you have no way to replace that, or at least no easy way to replace it. And that's where the dependency injection pattern comes into play. So what I'm going to do is introduce a dependency injection pattern to improve the testability of the code. And then after that, I'll also add dependency inversion so you can see what the difference is. And I'll close this example with a nice little tip about dealing with coverage and abstract classes. At the moment, the payment processor has too many responsibilities. It's responsible for creating the authorizer, for generating an SMS code, for actually authorizing it, and then dealing with the payment itself. So as a first step, let's move out creating the authorizer outside of the payment processor. So that means that payment processor needs to get an authorizer in some way. We can do it in two ways. We can pass it as a parameter to the pay method. We can also pass it in the initializer of payment processor. The advantage of passing it as an initializer is that perhaps we want to use that object in other places and other methods when we extend the payment processor. So I'm going to add an initializer method and then do it there. So this gets an authorizer and that's of type authorizer SMS. Now we don't need this line anymore and I just need to make sure that all of these are accessing this as an instance variable. Another thing I'm going to do is remove this line and change the payment processor such that it's no longer responsible for also generating this SMS code. Several reasons. First, because in a sense, it's not really a responsibility of the payment processor. And second, by removing it here, it allows me to have a bit more control over how the authorizer works. And I'll come back to that later. So let's remove this. And now that we have this, we can now start writing the test for the payment processor. So I'm going back to my test code here. And let's first add an initializer test. And the only task of the initializer test is to make sure that when we create a payment processor, that the authorizer is stored properly as an instance variable. So let's create that authorizer and pass it to a payment processor initializer. And now we only need to check that the instance variable is the same as the authorizer object that we passed as a parameter. So that's the first test. Second test is testing for successful payment. Let me remove this code. So here I'm creating an authorizer. And then I'm generating an SMS code. So I want to make sure that we test it with the correct authorization code. So I'm going to copy this over, then create the payment processor. And now we also need an order. And then I'm going to pay the order. And now I just want to make sure that the order status is properly set to paid. There you go. I can do something similar for the failure case. So again, creating an authorizer and generating an SMS code. But now I'm giving as a return value something that I know is going to be invalid. So I'm creating the payment processor and order. I just copy it over from here. And now instead of calling the pay method directly, I'm going to use the self-assert raises. So we're expecting some kind of exception here when we call the pay method, and the parameter is the order. So there we have our payment fail. And let's run this test to see what happens. Oh, that's of course not correct. There, that should be like that. Let's run this again. Yeah, now I have my 9 tests that are running. And let's also generate the HTML coverage report. So this is what it looks like. We've now reached a coverage of 100%. And we can see that it has run through each of these statements in the test that we just performed. So this is what dependency injection can do for you. It separates responsibilities for creating and using objects, and that's why it's also really helpful in writing more testable code, as you can see here. In terms of dependency though, payment processor is still directly dependent on the SMS authorizer, because we're passing it here as a parameter. And that means that if we want to add another type of authorization, at the moment payment processor doesn't support it because it expects an SMS authorizer. With dependency inversion, we create a layer in between that allows us to separate payment processor from authorization much more cleanly. So let's do that by introducing an abstract class that's going to serve as the separation layer. And let's call it authorizer. And that abstract class has 2 abstract methods. One method for performing the authorization, and the other method for checking if it is authorized. There we go. And now AuthorizerSMS becomes a subclass of the authorizer class that we just made. And because the payment processor only calls these 2 methods here, it doesn't need to know that it's dealing with an SMS authorizer. We can let it deal with an authorizer, which is the more abstract representation. Let me run these tests again. There we go. And then let's create the HTML, and you see we're going to get more or less the same thing. So reload this, except now we have a coverage report of only 98%. So why is that? Let's look into this. So here you see that because we added this abstract class, now our coverage is complaining that we didn't test these methods, which is true, we didn't. On the other hand, it's kind of useless to test these methods because they're abstract, and why would we need to do that? Because they're empty and they're not supposed to be implemented. There's 2 ways to solve this, basically. One thing that you can do is replace pass with a doc string. Let me show you how that works. So if we go here and then replace this with a doc string, so we're going to get this. This also allows you to write some documentation, which is pretty good. And then let's run that same test again and create the coverage report. And now you see that it actually ignores this because it's a doc string. So that's one way to do it. Another way to do it is that you create a .coverage.rc file where you explicitly tell coverage.pi to ignore things that are abstract. So let's do that as well. So I'm going to add a coverage.rc file here. There you go. And then inside that file, you write this. So basically, this means we don't want coverage report for anything that's abstract. Let's save this, and now let's run those tests again. Create the HTML file, and let's see what's happening. Now we see we're back at 100%. So why is dependency inversion important? Well, the main thing is it allows us to separate authorizers from payment processors in this case, and they don't need to know anything about each other, except payment processor only knows that there should be an authorize and an is authorized method. That's the only thing. But the result is that we can now add other authorizers and then use the payment processor with those, and before that wasn't possible. For example, we could add an authorizer that doesn't check an SMS code, but it checks whether you're a robot or not. Let's try that. So we're creating a new authorizer subclass. I'm just going to copy this over for the moment, and we're going to replace what we don't need. So this we don't need. We don't need to generate an SMS code. This can stay the same. But in the authorizer method, we're going to do something else. We're simply asking the user to confirm that they're not a robot. So we're asking, are you a robot? Yes or no? I mean, robots will never be able to answer this. And let's also convert this to a lowercase, so also uppercase letters work. And then authorize means that we answered no. Let's also write a few tests for this robot authorizer. So again, I'm going to copy over a part here. We also need to import it. So the first test is the initializer there. So let's test the success authorizer. It's going to be similar to this one. So I'm just going to copy that over. But the return value here is when it's successful, we should answer no, we're not a robot. And this should be a robot authorizer, and we don't have to generate an SMS code. So then basically this is what we get. And we can do the same thing with the fail, which is going to be very similar, but we're just going to pass no. There. So now authorize fails when we say yes, and it succeeds when we say no. We can also make a version that checks for uppercase. So let's add that too. Because obviously if we say uppercase no, this should also be correct. So this is what we have. Let's run the test one more time. There's a failure. Of course, here we should expect this to be false and not true. Let's try that again. Yes, there we go. And we generate the HTML one more time to see the coverage report. And our coverage is still nicely at 100%. So dependency injection is a pattern where we split creating the object from using the object by passing the object as a parameter. Dependency inversion means that we introduce an extra layer between objects in the form of an abstract class so that they are less directly dependent on each other. And that means you could replace one object with a subtype of another object. I hope this example clarifies the difference between dependency injection and inversion for you. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Thanks for watching. Take care. See you next time.